LG on red, back into picks and bans as you see the previous games. And we'll see what they have for each other here. Shenplay has been coming out for a few. Also could be a global possibility that these teams are favoring. But it seemed to be that tried and true, they're kind of sticking with the same compositions each time with slight adjustments.
Yeah, GSM will be very happy to opt into the exact same build that they've been finding success with previously in the series.
Yeah, interesting to see that we're not seeing many large switch-ups from CLG, especially with stuff like Tahmkent and Vladimir being banned, because you can always trade some of the OP champions unless they haven't necessarily practiced them themselves. So far, though, this is looking like a favorable thing for TSM, only because they won the first two games with very similar bans.
The Cassiopeia possibly coming in. They left that up once. They've kind of put it, or they did put it on the ban list as well. They are taking their time, considering how everybody on the team feels about it. I see Zix.
Honestly,
got the final call, and it is that Cassio.
Honestly, I'd like to see a CLG take a couple more cross map tools here. Maybe them actually try and prioritize the gangplank and get Darshan going. Oh, never mind. Too late.
Yeah, and then the other cross map tool you would have would be a Shen, but you don't want to lane Shen against gangplank in most situations because it allows gangplank a fairly free lane.
Yeah, even a bully lane.
So take the bottom this time. Even leave that jungler up, which we haven't seen Xmithy do. That's been a Gragas pick for CLG throughout these pick and ban phase. So they take the bottom lane and they say, TSM, show us your cards, at least a few more.
Yeah, the Jhin will allow them to help get a few picks here, and it can help them set up. It's like half of a cross map.
Yeah, and it does deny the combo of the Jhin plus Gangplank, so they're stealing it away from TSM as well. And that is definitely one of the big things that TSM were able to use against CLG in game number one.
I'm curious to see if Svenskeren goes with a Rek'Sai or a Gragas, since Xmithie's actually been prioritizing the Gragas over Rek'Sai, but it really seems like Svenskeren is totally comfortable in that side of the matchup. I don't think he has a reason to change. And yeah, locks in the Rek'Sai.
And AD Nidalee. No, they take the Braum. That's going to be locked in. Gets it for Biofrost, so he goes back to being a little bit tanky. We saw that in one of his three most played as he was matched up against Aphramu. His tank was Alistar. But I don't think we'll be seeing that here throughout the series. CLG goes for their pick side. Echo's open once again.
Yeah, so Echo is definitely one of the champions that you can take into Gangplank to go for those kills. And it looks like CLG will opt into a very similar strategy. They're giving away the Gangplank, and they're saying, we're going to take a favorable matchup into this Gangplank early, and we're going to try and kill you, push you into your turret, dive you, whatever it takes.
TSM, though, just putting together the same type of strong competition they can. Run at him fast with Lissandra. What's who he going to do here? Because he could very easily take the Echo mid, and they could throw a Gnar top lane and still be successful.
Yeah, it's just that Echo is such a good like counterpick into Gangplank in that lane. The breakpoint comes, even though we've seen this over and over, and where TSM, oh yeah, you go up to the Gangplank and Hanzo gets out and he's clearing all these waves and it looks great for TSM. There is a different road that matchup goes down. If CLG can actually convert on their focus top lane, they start killing Hanzo early, they deny him that early gold from Gangplank. Yeah. Gangplank is one of those champions where, yes, he gets bonus gold from killing minions. If you deny him early, it stifles the power curve for him so heavily that you can try and go for one of those early game wins. And CLG also drafting into the Jhin with the early armor penetration builds makes me think they're going to try and go for that style of play.
Kassadin?
It's holding. Time's up. And that Kassadin is going to be locked in for Counter Logic Gaming, who he takes it to the mid lane.
I love it. Another counter pick lane here for CLG. They've counter picked both of the lanes. Kassadin actually doesn't get pressured too hard by Lissandra. Early on, yeah, she has wave control, but who he should be able to CS under his turret, he should use his magic damage shield from the Q effectively to try and avoid getting harassed too low. So that mid lane isn't a real big point of pressure. We'll see how the matchup plays out, but it doesn't seem like Grishin should be able to have too much controller, and Hui's just trying to wait to get to that level 6, and then they have the possibility of Jhin setting up picks for Kassadin to chase down.
Ooh. Yeah, I like it as a counter pick, but he has never played Kassadin competitively. He's played 24 unique champions, now 25. first one on Cassidy.
Remember
in
his
an elimination game to go from the finals.
Remember his Varus game? Had never played or hadn't played Varus in over 2 months. And he says to the team, Varus, perfect counter pick. You guys trust me? His team said, yes, we trust you. And they won the game.
Yeah, you know what? 100% on that Varus.
Yeah, he has 9 champions. He's only played once. He's 6-3 on those champions. So his pocket picks are usually relatively successful.
And he's had 13 unique just this split. This is number 14 now in the playoffs. We'll see how they do. We're loading into game 3. Update your predictions for this match. Show your support with hashtag TSMWin or hashtag CLGWin. The faith has to be there as they enter into this final game. TSM says they're ready to get back to the stage, and Counter Logic Gaming's hearts are in it along with the fans to defend the title, and this could be their final chance. It's their say as they get themselves onto the Rift, and we'll have to see what happens. As I say this, we will have a slight pause.
There's that buildup again, Riv. You build us up. Okay, calm down.
Just comes crashing down. Where's the crescendo back down, Riv?
That's a tease, TSM.
Yeah. I mean, this is pretty crazy, actually. Like, the way COG has constructed this team composition with the Kasten mid and the Echo top, if TSM gets an early advantage and Doublo starts roaming around, like, where is the wave clear? CLG's towers
could just come
crashing down. Who needs it, right? The Echo, kind of, but a tank Echo doesn't clear the wave as well as an AP Echo would. Jhin, maybe. Like, it's something that COG has to be able to convert and snowball with fairly early.
Yeah. I mean, they've got a Gragas, early playmaking champion. They have an Echo into a Gangplank role. You know, they can try and, you know, punish that. They can even try and punish the bottom lane. Jhin is good at setting up and capitalizing on early ganks and trying to get, you know, pick kills there as well. So it is up to COG to make early action and be proactive in this game. But I like not backing down from the challenge, right? Their backs are against the walls. They're down 0-2 in this series. They have to make something spectacular happen here to change the way this series is going and get it back in their control. And they've opted into the double assassin snowball.
Well, panning out. We're going to change as well the way the pause is going because we are about ready to get onto the Rift. Let's open it up. We will fly through in our magical journey now to see if TSM will be able to take this game point, or if Counter Logic Gaming will keep their semi-final series hopes alive.
Yeah, and throughout this series, I also have to credit Doublelift and Biofrost in their laning phase. They've been put up against Aphromoo's Karma on a couple occasions, and even his Soraka. They did suffer that death early on, but their CS has been strong. They're not getting completely pressured out. And yes, Braum is one of the better melee supports to lane against range, but this is something that COG was able to push in and win by double-digit CS against most international mid lanes, and they haven't been able to do it against Dublin Bioforce.
Huzzah!
Hey, Gangplank's getting gold from this. He's got the mastery. So Hanser is the one with the last laugh here.
20 gold advantage right now.
Ching!
And
outsmarted.
Cleans off the gun. Let's get back to it again.
Baited.
So the line of scrimmage is set after a few love taps from mid and the top lane. Just figuring out what's going on and who's got the aggression. Looks like we're going to be obviously back to standard lanes, but the question is, why do CLG put themselves in that early game have to come out on top team with this casting?
Gotta change something.
Okay.
Right? He was pretty successful in lane as the Syndra. They've been reaching the mid and late game, and they've been getting outmaneuvered. TSM already brought more global pressure and late game scaling with the Gangplank picked early. Even the Sivir pick has tremendous late game. So COG, their option was, let's do pick comp double assassin and try and snowball these guys down.
By the way, that we kind of breezed over the mastery pick there from Hanser, but it's very common for Gangplanks because of parlay. To get the on hit for melee champions gold, which is normally a support mastery, but for Gangplank, it works really well in lane for trading because you can use your parlay on the enemy champion and you get gold plus harass that way rather than parlaying the minions, which causes you to lose out more lane control.
Really just a frugal build, if you will. Keeping himself financially stable in the early. First is going to be an Ocean Drake. You may see that go to the wayside for a bit here. It happened last game. The Drake was taken much later. CLG likes to get this, as they say, lane swap 2.0 on and really start to mix things up early. Might not be an option with this setup.
And this is what we're watching, right? The Lissandra early shove onto Huhi on the Kassadin. Yeah, Kassadin is going to get shoved in on most matchups, but it's about how he last hits under pressure and how many auto attacks from Bjergsen he does take. Bjergsen did a pretty good trade previously where we saw him go in for after the Q lands, get the extra auto for the Thunderlord's trigger, get some extra health down. Good job there again. He waits for the shield to fall off, then goes in for another triple hit after Thunderlord's cooldown comes back up. So Bjergsen's playing this pretty well and punishing him.
Until the team arrives in the mid. Hey, what is this?
Hey, you bully.
Get off of me.
Oh, the only thing that's missing really is Morgana. They have the karma. Is the follow-up there. Smithy holds the flash correctly. I mean, they all pulled off.
That play as a team.
They shoved the duo lane pretty far out, so they're not missing too much CS for that roam.
It seems so great. They all were just like, nah.
Team game, man. Five mid.
Oh,
jeez. All right, well, yeah, man, you said they have to switch something up. They have to try some new strategies here.
Just roll the die in mid. Why not?
They got his flash. We'll see if they can capitalize on it. You know, otherwise, those... While it is only a couple minions bottom, missing a couple melees is a big deal for the duo here.
It's trading a few minions bot for a few minions mid, and Huhi was really going to be in a struggling situation. Now he's got his Dark Seal and some boots, maybe dodge a few more skill shots. His potions are more efficient. Hopefully they can get Huhi to that point of power before Bjergsen can take over the game.
This is what I was talking about. Ekko has kill pressure on Gangplank. They bring the jungler up early. Good thing about Haunter that Haunter had previously placed his ward there, so he's able to see that gank, but not much he can do about this. Lane is pushing away from him, and the threat of the Gragas is definitely still there, so you kind of have to call your own jungler just to throw a Prey Seeker in there or something, just to check and ensure that you can push this wave up. That's what Spen is doing. They're not looking for any sort of gank kill here. They just want to allow Haunter to shove this lane into turret so he doesn't get frozen upon.
Yeah, the little fights Darshan is taking are in those minions, so it's almost like Haunter is forced to push the wave just to trade back the barrels, giving Darshan that little edge. Now he has a nice wave for himself. Bot lane getting pushed in as well. Should be easily cleared up by Stixxay and a grenade. Whoa, face check.
Nicely done, though. He's delaying the recall as Finskaren.
Who's winning in our game of recall interruptions? Yeah. Can't keep track. Bottom line and top lane have been constant.
Just toying with danger. Darshan looks like he's having a pretty good early game, matched up evenly with Haunter. As this bot lane is 47 to 38, both mid and bot down a few CS because of that roam previously. Who he has seemed to catch up.
Yeah, right. You can tell Smithy wants to try and gank the mid lane with the flash down, but if Bjergsen's being very conservative with his E, it's still going to be really tricky to secure any type of kill.
Yeah, it has to be Smithy interrupting the claw by either getting the body slam on Bjergsen during the last couple seconds of it so he can't reactivate it, or getting in between him and his base. Huhi is level 6 right now.
Yeah, double blam damage. You can call it that.
Yeah, you can call it that. I like it.
Bjergsen, he had to hit it. Level 5 there doesn't have the ability to make himself invulnerable, and he's got to play it safe now.
Yeah, if Huhi shifts forward again, he'd be in danger of a Svenskeren gank on Rek'Sai. Everyone on COG, at least the solo lanes, are playing really aggressively and would be vulnerable to Svenskeren ganks, but I think that has to do with their mindset of trying to take over this game early.
Yeah, the mindset as well as the matchups that they've drafted into. The onus is on them. They have to be the proactive ones. They have to create with these choices with the double assassins and the Jhin bottom lane. If they let TSM just farm up, that's exactly what TSM want. You know, Haunter on Gangplank, he's gonna farm up, try and get all that bonus gold. Sivir, once he gets the core items, is a monster, and they can have a repeat of last game where they can, you know, group up, control all neutral objectives, and have the extra team fight superiority. So TSM, they need to cut them off and not let them have access to that early gold.
It's always scary to fight against TSM, especially when they get early gold in the early game. But even if you make the 45-minute mark at an even pace, that's when TSM's fights are ridiculous. They strategize so well, they entered the fight well, and we've seen a lot of past seasons come into TSM's favor. I should say games in past seasons because of those 45-minute TSM fights are so powerful. So it's almost like you're playing in a danger zone the entire time against these guys.
Interesting how COG just keep up this top lane focus, even though they keep giving away the gangplank and Haunter keeps outplaying and keeps, you know, clearing minion waves, gaining advantages on the other side of the map by avoiding death topside. COG continue to focus on it and try and pressure him. Ooh.
All right. Good trade back.
Damage off. Low cooldown on Lissandra Q.
Where are you going?
Just back a little bit. Drink some potions. I'll be right back, man.
Over here.
Yeah, I got your cooldown out. All right. Honestly, though, Bjergsen's ultimate being down is, you know, worth keeping track of for CLG. We've got those deep wards, though, that TSM have gotten. So they're going to see this move from CLG as they try and collapse and defend the Drac.
I wonder how this is going to be for Huhi when he becomes a priority target without cleanse as well against Bjergsen. As he tries to jump in and assassinate, things are going to get tough.
It's really tough, especially if they get to the mid to late game team fights. It's more about can Huhi make an impact chasing people around the map? Can CLG create long type of fights?
Keep him running.
Yeah, Huhi needs the threat of Stixxay's ult behind him. If there's a Kassadin running at you with Jhin bullets firing right behind, then it's extremely scary. And you kind of are forced into the, I have to run rather than stand and fight the assassin, which is where you want to be. And in order to do that, they need lane pressure somewhere. Ooh, interesting setup here. Aframu should be able to leave, though. As,
the guessing game
completes.
Now, once again, the laning phase is actually going over to TSM. The duo lane is winning. I feel like COG with Styx and Aframo kind of gave it to him when they decided to roam mid at level 2. Haunts are in the top lane, despite a lot of presence by Xmithie early, has been able to farm out on Gangplank. Very impressive once again.
Flash is still back up. See, now the thing is, oh, he saw the ward being placed, so he knows Smithy's there. But previously to that, Huhi has set this precedent that I'm going to go aggressive on you on Kassadin and trade constantly. Making Bjergsen guess whether the jungler is there or not, because Huhi has been doing it regardless whether Smithy is there or not. And you kind of play that mind game of when do I call his bluff? You know, is the jungler here this time? He continues to trade aggressively into me.
Yeah.
Well, he shows those aggressive shades through his buys. Bjergsen continues to go with that Negatron cloak as a purchase, while Huhi always wants that damage first, no matter what he's playing. And he'll forgo that kind of Abyssal Scepter in the early part. Trying to get those kills.
Oh, here comes Stixxay. He's moving up with a Jhin as well.
Locked him down. Biofrost gets a very nice Glacial Fissure out. Spreads the distance. Huhi gets locked in. Void Rush coming out. Safety from Svenskeren now as he enters the fight. And Bjergsen is bounced around from Xmithie. Doesn't look like anybody's going to go down in this one. But it's definitely a test of the power right now.
Yeah, that was a good move there from Double Lift. He moved up to auto-attack Stixxay to force Stixxay to close up shop there on the ultimate and not fire any further bolts after Biofrost. So Huhi had to give up on that chase, and they disengage. I think they come out a little bit ahead in Summoners as Bioburn broke, though. So. Yeah.
And if TSM extends this laning phase and continues to gain, what is, 1,000 gold already, it's going to be pretty good for them. So Double Lift just kind of moving up, preventing the invade from working. It did cost both summoners from Biofrost, but ultimately, it seems to be pretty okay for TSM as of now.
Looking to play it slow. Doesn't seem like Bjergsen's really got too much aggression onto Huhi in the mid lane. But they did try to aggress with Stixxay, practically the whole team on Bjergsen. We haven't seen anything like that as of sort, so maybe CLG just had kind of a one-off ready in the early game.
Looking to pressure that Kassadin turret for the first turret gold here and punish Kassadin's lack of wave clear.
And Svenskeren's even keeping Xmithie away, so he won't be able to assist with the next wave. I love that roam there by TSM. Very smart adapting to a different pick in the mid lane. As opposed to doing the quick swap up top, we actually see the swap down mid.
Jhin's not a very quick turret taker himself, so no real turret damage given up on the bottom side there by TSM. And, you know, I said the onus was on CLG to create early action and, you know, make some proactive moves. They have tried a little bit in the mid lane, got a flash down, and he's been trading aggressively, but no real headway gain here on any area of the map for Counter Logic Gaming. As Darshan doesn't have a CS lead himself either, and TSM are very happy with the calm pace of the early game.
The hope maybe is that these teleports can come into play, but you have to consider it's matched by TSM this game as well, as mid laners have both brought the teleport, not just the top laners. Things very conditional here for CLG and how they can approach this game. Looks like they're the safe one right now is the door they're choosing.
Yeah, and with Drake still being up, it's an Ocean Drake right now. The teams don't seem to be putting a huge priority on it. It is TSM putting the pressure on, just committing to this first turret, and looks like they're going to be able to get it. But will CLG match with the fight is the question, and the threat of that fight is what's keeping TSM off of it.
What you need to do in this situation is use your weakness to your advantage. You can use first turret gold as bait sometimes. Mm-hmm. And yes, it is super risky, and you don't want to be in that position, but CLG's mid turret is about to go down, and what you need to do there is try and use TSM's focus on that objective against them and try and set something up, because if you break the game open there using mid turret as bait and try and get a collapse, and hey, you've got Jhin ultimate, you've got some flat armor penetration, even though it's just the serrated dirk right now, you know, and cast it in chase down, that could be a way for them to, you know, really ignite this comp and start things in their favor. TSM don't overcommit though. Intelligent there. They just take these quick roams and don't stick around.
Because they know if they don't get overcommitted on, they will eventually get that mid lane turret. Or they can get a side lane turret if COG overcommit in the defense of the mid. The only other thing that could happen is if Darshan could continue to push in Haunter. But with the Gangplank getting higher and higher levels, I do feel like that's highly unlikely.
And look at Haunter too. He's literally sitting at his turret, waiting for the minion wave to come to him. Then he just CSs under his turret, and he's just fine doing that. He can consistently clear this without putting himself in real danger. And there's not really a threat there. He's actually winning his CS because Darshan's missing a couple while trying to shove.
Both AD carries now backing with around 2,000 gold after being in lane. You could almost tell how long they've been out as everybody's just backing to switch out those sweepers. It had been a few levels back and forth. So lots of money to spend, lots of unknown power here to come out if there is an engage once these items are finished, and a little bit of rough housing in the top lane from Svenskeren and Darshan. He knows he's safe, so he's just giving him a hell of a time.
Yeah, but they defend finally top falls. And now they can get mid.
There it is. Whoa! That's the fight play. As soon as it goes down, Vilefrost trying to be a meat shield. Glacial Fissure goes down. He flashes out, and Doublelift already made the distance of Curtain Call. How? Oh, what a play there by TSM to avoid the death.
That is the exact play I was talking about for CLG, and TSM avoid it. They get the turret, and they get out afterwards scot-free. Very big win for them, and that is kind of heartbreaking for CLG. Darshan now under fire.
Trinity Force completed for Haunter, and he's really quick. He's going to try and chase Darshan down for a while here.
Doesn't have too many barrels left. Oops. Into the artillery. Looks like he's going back.
Oh, so he's trying to get Baron. Haunter could gangplank all this. This is dangerous for COG.
Whoa, Biofrost jumps in as he's already low. That's going to be a kill and a dragon going over to his smithy as he says, see you later. If everybody can make it out, we are well off on this one. And it looks like Biofrost may just stay. Goes for the slow, but still flashes out to save himself. They're calling time for Stixxay. And he gets taken down as he tries to come in on the backside.
I think that was a play born of desperation from CLG. They wanted to re-engage that to try and get some kills back for them right now.
Yeah.
Because they feel the game slipping away from them. They wanted to re-engage with Stixxay and Huhi at the same time to take down Bjergsen, but Bjergsen plays it calm, gets a stand-up counter kill, and TSM, even though they give away that Drake and a kill, in the end, they still have map control. They're still shoving up.
Yeah, I feel like Biofrost was a little ambitious giving away first blood, but then because TSM had the accumulated advantage, they were able to convert on the very dangerous situation CLG had put themselves in. Gonna watch this one more time. And like you said, Biofrost is already low, and he kind of just hopped in to help out Svenskeren before instantly dying. Then the continuation of this play is something where Aphromoo was most likely dead, but COD was hoping they could pull off some kind of flank onto Bjergsen here.
Yeah, Aphromoo did have flash still, so he probably could have got away. It felt like COD wanted to re-engage on Bjergsen, but they didn't respect the flash there.
Yeah.
And Bjergsen, you know, quick thinking there, boom, gets the counter kill. TSM, don't stop.
And this is also what we're worried about for as far as COD is concerned from the draft phase. Unless they are threatening TSM with kills, the waves are just going to collapse onto COG's turrets. And two turrets to zero right now, plus the ward coverage in the jungle. Haunts are looking stronger every single wave. Everything pushing for TSM, and very few things COG can do to get back outside of Brawl, where they're already down.
It seems like this, the way they played in the first game with the Aurelion Sol in, where they were just on the bottom turret immediately, on the top turret immediately, trying to create pressure, is where they needed to help Huhi and get Huhi. He still hasn't gone down, has been able to absorb all the necessary experience here up to 17 and a half minutes in. So a few kills could really catapult him to where he needs to be a side lane bully here, along with Darshan. 166 to 142 in that matchup, not too bad, but Haunter's got some completed items already and is ready to go back for more.
Yeah, pretty insane how well he's been able to farm so far. Already gained 500 gold from just his parlay. Oh my goodness.
Absolutely demolished.
Yeah, if it wasn't looking bad for COG before, it definitely is now. The proto-belt Lissandra right there. Bjergsen just demolishes the duo lane of COG with the help from Svenskeren, and TSM is going to look to continue to push.
Yeah, TSM have worked this whole split in preparation for this. Let's see if Darshan can get one back here. He's trying to make him down double.
There's not even a turret out here. Mid lane's already down, and TSM is running around the mid lane after losing a few.
Going to get back into that one. They just fought. I was a little worried about that because Bjergsen just used his ultimate, but they just get out. They're all right. They lose double.
Yeah, they get something back on the other side.
That's what CLG needs to identify, though. That's the play they need to go hard on.
They're going to watch the Stixxay Nathan Root kick off here. Oh, Stixxay can't quite flash in time as Bjergsen's ultimate is already pre-casted by the time it flashes.
And look at the Fog of War during that play as well. TSM have so much control because they've still got all their turrets up and they've been winning the Vision Wars.
Yeah.
So, you know, very dangerous there for the Jhin and Karma. Darshan, though, you know, he gets that kill on the double lift and he gets some turret gold for themselves up top. It's just so many steps for CLG to get back into this game, and that's just the first one down that path.
20 minutes in now. TSM doing a great job at holding the outer line. This is very reminiscent of TSM of old, being able to keep their turrets up for a very long time. Just denying a team gold that way, as well as being able to slightly win their lanes. It's a lot of small things that pile up into that snowball that allow TSM to continue aggressive engages like such. But they lost double lift last time.
Mm-hmm.
But that's exactly where CLG can get back into this one. Who he wasn't actually able to participate coming into that play, but the rest of the team was getting a little bit on.
Yeah, it's just so difficult right now for CLG. They just have to hard commit everyone to one side of the map if they want to catch anyone. Because Sivir's so fast, Lissandra can self-ult and claw away, and Gangplank's been extremely slippery, plus just playing cautiously. So CLG, they just have to, you know, five-man commit to somewhere, try and get the Jhin ult and cast it and chase down. Otherwise, TSM win this game slowly.
And the trickiest part of that is even if CLG does five-man commit, and let's say they kill three people. Let's say they get the perfect collapse on three people on TSM. They still might lose that trade because the other two lanes would continue to push, most likely take a turret, and it could still be gold positive for TSM. So really, COG has to pull out something extremely creative.
Well, they said there was a lot of that faith. It's kind of renewed for Huhi. Continuously keep him kind of concentrated on the game. They put a cast in his hands here, coming into a possible elimination game for that test, or that contest for their title. Boogie now the focus. Gonna be able to get out a little bit, but only gonna be more assists going over to TSM. McSmithy tries to help him out in the I think I can situation, and he is right, he can. He doesn't go down himself. But they can't be going down like this across the board if they want to produce results.
Yeah, and TSM knows how vulnerable CLG is right now, and they are not relenting their pressure. Bjergsen at 4-0 continues to get picks. It's also timed with the respawn of the Drake, so they can just go right back and get it. All their waves are shoving. All of CLG is lost for what to do, and TSM can only extend their lead and get closer to the finals.
Yep, they're working towards that changing of the guard. CLG have had the last two championships in the North American LCS. But if TSM defeat them here, they will have one of our previous champions as Cloud9 await them in the finals.
It's pretty incredible. There have been three teams that have found consistent playoff success. CLG has two titles. C9 has two titles. TSM has three. C9 already waiting for the winner of this match in the finals. So TSM hoping to get their fourth split title.
And there's something to be said about the strengths of all three of those organizations behind the players as well, because the players have changed, yet these teams are ones that stay at the top of the table in the NALCS. We've seen changes not help teams, and they continue to fall. But now these guys are still at the top. 22:30 on the clock, 4-2 here as TSM slowly working their advantage. And they realize that CLG knows they're behind. They could, both teams feel this in the game, so they're very wary of what CLG could try to produce here. But know they still have to push the aggression inside the game.
Know that they still have to play smart.
Yep.
They can set up the plays. They have double teleport as well as every lane pretty much winning right now. So it's about deep wards. It's about waiting for CLG to collapse and punishing the other side or just creating their own advantages. Svenskeren just taking away the jungle that's moving now and even dueling Darshan. Doesn't care.
And comes away at max health. Able to regen with the passive right after. And it's, you know, the good life for TSM right now. Up 2-0 in the series, huge lead in this game. Plus they have stronger comp for the late game. Full vision control. All the options are open to them as they prepare to head to Toronto. I was told actually by a tweet, it's pronounced Toronto with no T.
Oh.
Yeah. Today I learned.
Toronto?
Maybe someone else.
Jack?
You're Canadian.
Canada's,
how is it?
Canada's
is it
first
Toronto?
Song? What's the answer?
I think or is that I've just said Toronto a lot, but I think enough people say Toronto that I just kind of zone it out.
Is it just the colloquial or is it a...
Toronto.
Okay.
I didn't say it. You're putting my credibility on the line.
Come on,
right
Canadian.
Now.
How long? I think, you've been in the U.S. for too long.
I think you'll be all right. They're nice people. They're not going to boo you out if you stay wrong. 25 minutes coming up on the clock here, and TSM continue to grow their lead. Haunter, now being a menace to Darshan, pretty much can't match up with him too strong on the outside.
Yeah.
And who he trying to keep up in CS with Bjergsen. The minions will keep pushing back towards CLG here as TSM has these outer turrets, but that's the scary part, is that CLG can't even start to farm that without being pressured by TSM.
Yeah, CLG shouldn't be too disheartened either, even though they are looking like they'll probably lose this, because they have the most championship points. They won Spring Split.
Mm-hmm.
They have a very good chance. If they can win third place, even in the third place match, if it comes to that, then they will be able to go to Worlds qualifying on championship points.
This might not be the time to tell CLG fans that like TSM.
Yeah, I'm just kidding. What's actually going to happen is even if CLG finishes third or fourth, if TSM wins the split, CLG will have the most points.
Right.
But if... I'm not 100% sure on the third place, second place scenario, so a lot of stuff that will be explained a little bit later.
Oh. The fight's to come in, buying time for himself in the first bit of action, really, we've seen in the past 5-10 minutes. As TSM look to work top on two.
Yeah, really, everyone's just thinking right now, what's going to be that little interaction
what breaks it open?
That sparks the big fight,
yeah.
Right? Yeah. What's going to be the one that, you know, provokes CLG to actually go for that kind of desperation play to get back in this game? Is it going to be a fight over a pink ward? What will they actually commit to here? Because they've got, you know, they can bide their time and make their choice carefully because. They will probably only get one choice at it.
Yeah, one chance. I think it's going to be around Baron, but it's slow going just because TSM doesn't have an incredibly fast Baron taking team.
Oh, that's not it.
It isn't. He didn't make it out.
Practically 2v1ing to start this one off. Bjerg bites off a little more than he can chew and calls for
Svenskeren.
Nice shots from Stixxay, and Bjergsen thinks
he's safe.
He used the flash there and goes down. Svenskeren getting tied up now. A nice ultimate coming in from Haunter kind of deters CLG. They have to pull back with low HP amongst many members. But they get a nice kill. They get a bit of an opening. Where can they go with it?
Well, they're trying to get more.
That's Biofrost locked up. A few more hits. Darshan could be in and out with Huhi. The shot's a 6-8, but the shield is there from Aphramu's Mantra Shield. And Darshan is now trying to get Svenskeren and the rest of the team to focus him. But nobody can deliver enough damage.
Coming.
To get the kill.
GP trying to flank up the side. Double lift, corralling COG back to their base. That fight was a little bit odd because Bjergsen could have saved himself if he just self-alted that last shot. Maybe he was playing a bit of a mind game. Even with all of that, TSM got a turret off the back.
Weird mind game to play.
Yeah, he's not going to fire the last bullet. I did. Whoops.
But I mean, if you look at the cost-benefit analysis of that, particular
well,
game.
I wonder if he self-ults, if even after he gets the heal, if the fourth shot still would have been enough to kill him. Because the curtain call has a really long time where he can hold it. I think he should have self-ulted. Or you can just ult while it's in the air. That works too.
Very true.
Let's call it a mistake.
Is there any reason why it was on cool? Were you sure he had it up?
98%.
Oh.
I'm as sure it was.
There's a chance.
I'm as sure as the name is the pronunciation of Toronto.
All right, so it probably wasn't enough. Here we are at it. Curtain call goes down. Snixay's looking for some actors. It looks like he'll find Hauntzer on the backside. Good showing. Nothing comes of it, however, and it looks like this scene breaks apart for now. That's an all down for Snixay, so they have to realize they can really be jumped on here. Aphra moves to safety provided for him, but they don't continue to engage in this fight.
Hauntzer's joining the team now with all of his money. So
yeah.
Very, very powerful.
What's that rich boy Hauntzer comes over here with
his 12,500 gold.
The three items completed. CLG also don't have Jhin ult, so they don't really have many options. And they try and go for the steal with the Deadly Flourish, but not going to be the case. And TSM can back off with their winnings.
Yeah, only one kill advantage, but 8,000 gold lead for TSM. You can tell they've had control of the map for most of this game. Killing a lot of turrets.
All right, TSM, actually, I mean, CLG actually pushing up the mid lane there to try and gain a little bit of position. Now they're going for the engage onto Hauntzer.
Pressuring it hard. Farsight Orb went just down behind CLG, so TSM has seen all the members here to fight. They're walking by that ward once again, and they give themselves some secrecy. Looks like for their troubles, they get a push, and Snixay still there in the mid lane. We'll see if they can finally break open this mid turret, but it looks like it won't be enough time. So fun. Bjergsen on Lissandra, double lift on Sivir. One of them could be there, and they clear the wave. Both of them there, and you have no chance to take a turret. So CLG keeps coming up empty-handed, even with a bit of an advantage here.
Yeah.
We also know it's not over till it's over. COG have been able to manufacture plays in the past. They're going to need a lot of them, though. They need to win this game and then two more if they want to try and maintain their championship streak.
The COG comeback factory needs all your faith right now because this is going to be a doozy.
Are you doubting them right now, Kobe?
I'm not. Never.
Never doubting them.
Maybe a little bit.
You're saying doozy? Doozy doesn't equal doubt? We'll see. It is definitely going to be tough. But the faith remains, as you said, Kobe. A lot of the fans are still there, and CLG believes it too. We've seen it come down to some crazy, crazy all-out fights that have left Snixay and the support up.
Yeah.
That have left a few other members up just to come out on top and win the game. So CLG knows what it takes here in these late-game fights. But like I said, it becomes a danger zone always when you're playing against TSM. Very, very scary is how powerful they are at this point in time.
Stalled out a little bit, but we were kind of expecting this because of the no Mountain Drake spawning and TSM not having the fastest Baron taking team. Mm-hmm. Because once again, they're in a team composition with Sivir. Their siege isn't necessarily that great, but if they can catch COG in the open, they can run them down and crush them with their gold advantage and overall team fighting.
Hauntzer waiting. Hauntzer pushing the bottom lane up as well. All the side lanes are always in favor of TSM.
Yeah.
And that allows them to have this vision control to remove options for CLG. Because CLG have to have that five-man guerrilla warfare squad where they run at you from Fog of War and try and pick someone off and then try and chain that into extra chase down kills with Kassadin and Jhin. With TSM playing so safe, you know, disengaging constantly, then shoving up waves, it really removes so many of those options. Because not only do the wards inside the jungle help TSM be alerted to CLG's plays, but also the minions moving up the mid lane, up the side lane, serve as vision themselves. Every time you push up the minions, those gain vision of CLG members as well, who are, you know, forced to go clear them out.
Sean, only getting so much room until Hauntzer enters the lane. Definitely a growth for Hauntzer as well. From what we saw in his time on Gravity to now his time on Team Solo Mid, making, creating his own opportunities, as well with the confidence of the rest of the team, makes a lot of this basically unstoppable at times.
Yeah.
TSM taking a few love taps here, but obviously not deterred from an initial push now in this lane.
Pretty lackluster ultimate there from Snixay. You can see with his item build, he's not optimizing for the armor penetration. He went for a rapid fire cannon instead of what you'd expect of a Maw from other Jhins who are really trying to get that armor penetration. I would have actually preferred the Maw, especially because he's dealing with Lissandra, but maybe he's just hoping to get that one long range shot into the picks that CLG is hoping for.
Yeah, I feel like CLG do have to go full offensive mentality try and get, you know, the possibility of picking somebody off. Yeah. But it is a low possibility, and they haven't found it here as TSM consistent disengages. That's why we keep building up this story. Of course, everything's going according to plan for TSM if they can just keep it slow like this. Look at the gold lead has been ballooning over the last 10 minutes. Yeah. 20 minutes, actually. Even.
It's a 3,000 gold lead now for Haunzer. He has just been free farming. He's got two of his three cannon barrage upgrades already, I believe. Well, it's a bunch of gold.
TSM looking for a pick of their own.
Aphromuth has to get away from the team. Locket of the Iron Solari on himself, but they are able to turn around. Haunzer is pulled back. They said too far. Fight as
gone.
Who he's coming from the back, and now Aphromuth keeps himself safe as he tethers in Svenskeren. They can't join the fight against Huhi, but he won't last long anyways. And like you said, Darshan out of this fight. Looks like he's teleport not in. And now down, he has to walk all the way upriver to help the team and stop that split push they've been trying to get going.
Yeah, Haunzer, it looked like he could have chased down Aphro for the kill, but you can see the dedication of TSM to their shot calling, right? As soon as Darshan shows up, they go, everyone focus him now. They turn around. They even let him walk away. Here goes the Baron. Initiation, though, from TSM.
They don't kill it that fast, so it is a little bit dicey here.
Well, Frost, stand behind me, everyone, as they scatter left and right trying to dodge themselves. They do have to give up Baron. The pressure is too great from CLG. And it looks like the mid lane will still be defended.
Yeah, CLG live to continue the fight. Infernal Drake will be up soon. TSM is a little bit low right now, so I'm thinking CLG might try and rush this Infernal Drake for a bit of a chance. It's a little bit desperate here because Bjergsen can teleport in, and that's what's going to happen.
10,000 gold down. I think TSM would be happy to take this fight now, actually.
Even with the health bars not being full.
Well, all convergence is in. They're just trying to throw that pocket sand. Sifa says, you can get it in their eyes, but it doesn't work. They blow it right away. Goggles, they do work this time. TSM is coming out on top, left and right on this third game here. Really not giving CLG any room to work with. CS leads in just about every lane, and it's been an incredible season for TSM being able to do this to the majority of the teams they played against. Not flawless, though, letting themselves get trapped, being taken down by Phoenix 1 throughout the split
the legendary
well. So
Inori game.
They aren't flawless. It's something teams can
take series, right?
Yeah.
That's the most surprising thing. It wasn't just a stray game that TSM gave away. It was the best of three series. Phoenix 1 were able to take two and...
It is crazy to think that if not for that Phoenix 1 series, TSM could have been the first undefeated North American team in a split. Because they tied Immortals at 17.
They're about to head to the finals, and you guys got a nitpick on the one thing. Are you a TSM fan, chat? You're supposed to block that one out of your mind.
I'm a non-biased caster, Kofi.
Yeah, same. Honestly, though, especially for us to have known all of the players for so long, it's just really fun to see any of them succeed, because all of the players on all these teams who have been playing for so long want it so much. Mm-hmm. You can hear it in all the videos that they do. Everybody's got their eyes on the championship, right? It's so emotional for all of these players.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you heard what Darshan said, what it means to play in that third place match. He does not want to play in that third place match. He is going to try to have a say about it. He can get his. That's the Guardian Angel. He still has the chrono break. If he slams it when he comes up, he's holding on to it for now. Tries to take more damage and get himself back to get a slight heal. And they do keep themselves alive. Huhi has gone down with double lift, so DPS down on both sides. Stops the fight, and CLG holds the front end of the base.
Ooh, man, what a crucial hold there for CLG. Smithy, yes. Gragas ultimate on double lift. Gets him to the team, but they're not
done.
Oh,
no, Smithy.
Smithy, I'm sorry. We were cast a curse talking about him.
Oh, it was a crucial hold until they thought TSM had backed away. The one for one at that stage of the game, so difficult to accomplish. But now with three people down, looks like TSM's going to get that bear.
This was far, a hold until it wasn't.
This far in the game, that far down in gold, you have to expect you don't own anything on the map. And they are always going to be in that next brush, right next to you. This is the chance this time around. And TSM are going to walk over with Baron after those three kills.
Pretty good for a CLG here as TSM's pushing up for the turret. Jin opens up. Specifically, though, being able to get Doublelift really low before you even cask him into the team.
Duskblade proc!
And then Duskblade ruins his life there. But instead of just going back to base, healing up, Xsmithie's like, I think TSM is gone, but they are definitely not. Bjergsen had swept. Easy kill there for TSM.
And Stixxay goes to try and help him out, but no exit path available for him. But
that's the rate that CLG has to play at, right? I think we have a second. I need to get higher levels. I need more resources. Xsmithie tries to go into the jungle immediately, hoping that that wasn't the case. They're really being pressured in to make some moves that they may not want to make here. And TSM has been able to kind of work off that throughout every team they've played against this season. Create those errors that they can play against. Very good position to be sitting in. Fighting outside the base, or at least trying to taunt a little bit here. CLG is going to go ahead and clear some very bold room towards its turrets are getting taken down.
See Hanser with a lot of items already. Able to chunk on Doohee. No Infinity Edge though, so he doesn't get the one shot onto Doohee. CLG would basically have to engage on this if they want to save this game. They're going to try and poke down as much as possible. This is really tough. TSM so close. Punching their ticket to the finals to get another final against Cloud9.
It has been an arduous journey for TSM back to the top of the North American LCS. Oh, here we go!
Bjergsen knocked back, but TSM is actually piled onto a great group that will be able to fight back. Darshan comes back up as well. He's going to get knocked once or twice. Hanser trying to stay on the side and keep everybody at bay. They find Darshan, Xsmithie, and Hoohee share about 1,000 health apiece and have to head back. And now it does not look good as the base starts to fall. And TSM is starting to do what many thought would occur here in a 3-0 against CounterLogic Gaming.
Oh, got a block!
So much discipline from TSM and the way they're disengaging and not overcommitting this fight, but Hoohee desperately trying to chase.
Yeah, be careful though. CLG actually don't have enough members to really threaten that four-man squad as TSM able to disengage and get right back to base. All right, here it is again. CG, they try and make their move as the turret is going down. TSM are so far ahead though. Zoning with the Gangplank ultimate, then they re-engage and focus on Darshan here as Bjergsen gets the double root on Hoohee and Darshan.
Yeah, and then the self ult too. Even after Bjergsen got Grog assaulted into the team, he knew he wasn't under immediate threat, so he saved his ultimate for that crucial moment in the team fight.
Everything becomes crucial now for CounterLogic Gaming. Hanging on by a thread, Hoohee tries to put a little bit of damage on, soften up what they can of TSM before they make it in the base, but they're almost trading more than it's worth every time they go in. Just a few shots from Doublelift and Darshan can't step any closer here. And the turret slowly being whittled down. CLG may make a move as it falls, and the parallel convergence is not worked on right now. CLG is looking for the perfect entry.
TSM's just all grouped up because they know how strong they are. Won't let CLG get a flank on them.
See if they can make the entry. Biofrost protects Doublelift beautifully on the back line. They throw the ultimate onto Jin. And the global ults really make it hard for someone like him to stay still, throw down his ultimate, and they can't provide that defense they require.
Yep, it's a very clear game plan for TSM this game. This is not a flashy win. This is a comp win, yes. We know CLG have to take risks, and they're obviously showing their hand, trying to take a bunch of those risks, and TSM, they play conservatively, they bide their time, and they cash in.
Like 10 said, kills now.
They have the deed to this land. They continue to move their borders up farther and farther, and Xsmithie finds that out every time he tries to farm something.
But it is impressive the way that TSM is winning these games. They're identifying the win conditions, and then just tunneling in and doing exactly that thing. Here, they knew if it goes late, they're going to be able to outfarm the lanes and have a massive advantage by the time the game is over. Well, it's not quite over, but that's a 18,000 gold lead in Elder Drake with 3 stacks, 2 inhibitors down, and maybe the final push to send them into finals.
It's going to be the final inhibitor, that's for sure. It doesn't mean CLG cannot protect it. Darshan up towards that top lane, trying to keep the wave as small as possible so they have time to focus on the bottom. The turrets are falling like they're made of butter right now. And the favorite team solo mid.
Why did we get Butter Turret?
I have no idea. That's how you get it with three Drakes and the Elder on top of that. Not even one of them is a mountain. And they're slicing right through him. This could be the final go. Darshan and the rest of the team are going to try to go for Broke. His Guardian Angel gets popped as the Glacial Tomb with the same
double from
Erickson. And he did. 60 seconds on the clock. That means TSM is fighting 4v5 with the Fountain just on the heels of CLG for HP. That's who he's going down now. Aphromoo is going to be the next one to fall as they can't break enough ground between them and TSM to get the heals from the Fountain. And it's now going to be Senskaren tanking up so the team can go under the turret. Darshan firing back with Xmithie, and they're able to slow the attack but not stop the attack. The Nexus turrets fall at the same time. The focus is on the Nexus, and TSM will not be stopped as they take a 3-0 game. Xmithie again, like Darshan says, walk this way, away from the Nexus, but TSM will take it. They will head to Toronto, and they will challenge C9 for the finals of the NALCS Summer Split.
And this is vindication for TSM after suffering the defeat to CLG in the finals in Las Vegas a few months ago. And that has got to feel good because it wasn't just a victory, it was a 3-0 victory.
Hard work paying off for Team Solo Mid.
And also because of the win and their second place finish in spring, we don't know if they'll be the number one seed yet, but TSM is definitely going to Worlds.
Absolutely, another team locked in. It's been happening all around the world, and it's amazing to see that list continue to be created. And now TSM, with their strongest split, locks themselves in.
You guys are getting me excited for Worlds again already. Every time I get hope for North America. Super amped up heading into Worlds.
Yeah, and we still have the NA Finals is the thing right here, and the road is so much different than last split. TSM entered as the sixth seed in the spring. Now they are the number one seed, prohibitive favorites, and no reason to think they aren't the strong favorites against Cloud9.
And honestly, the reason why I have more hope going into Worlds this year than any previous North American year heading into Worlds is because of the extra focus of the North American teams on the macro play and the mental fortitude. Teams have been specifically hiring staff members to train them in the anti-tilt, basically,
yep.
What everyone's been calling it. But it really has shown, and it really has helped these teams in these long best of fives.
Looking at these games as well, and can't pass it up, a very unfortunate situation for Counter Logic Gaming and the Aurelion Soul removal throughout this series. Mm-hmm. And this was something as well, as Bjergsen said the first time, that they were ready to allow that to play through if it weren't to happen again, because they knew also what that meant to Counter Logic Gaming.
Yeah, it was an unfortunate situation, but I also think that TSM, beyond that first game with the Aurelion Soul out, had three fairly convincing victories.
Completely dominating.
It sucks anytime we have to have something like that happen, but TSM definitely deserved their victory here. They played really well.
Coming out very strong. We also saw the kind of progression that Counter Logic Gaming was talking about and how they had fixed that behind the scenes things, and they were able to focus on the game. And we saw that coming out a little bit in the early game pressure where they were all over TSM, but it just seems TSM, obviously, they're like, oh yeah, we get back into this role and they just can't be stopped.
Obviously, CLG doesn't want to play in the third place match, but just because they lose to TSM, who has been dominating everyone, it doesn't necessarily mean they're a bad team. So I'm really looking forward to the third place match in Toronto and also towards Worlds, because we're not sure exactly who's going to be going. And TSM, C9, like, it's all going to be on the line next week.
I'm excited. Obviously, we've seen a lot of changes and the teams adapt here coming towards the split. TSM, this split, as I said before, the teams coming in with changes have just been able to catapult themselves back to success. And I can't wait to see what that power does for the other teams as P1, who actually learned to beat the best team in the league throughout that learning process. So what happens next split, baby?
Gotta bring it up again.
Rengar!
What are we gonna get? Oh, stop it. For now, the scoop on this rival.